knows a lot about all kinds of stuff. Professor Dave Explains.
Earlier in this series, we defined goods and services, and we also used the concept of specialization to rationalize that it is easier to purchase something that we need rather than to learn how to produce it ourselves. But how do we know what the price should be for a good or service? The answer to this question is supply and demand. These words refer to the amount of stuff that exists and how much consumers are willing to pay for it. By analyzing how the cost of something affects how much people are willing to buy it, one can become able to predict how consumers will react to a change in price. Let's begin by looking at demand. Demand is the relationship between the quantities of goods and services that consumers desire, or demand to consume, and the prices those consumers are willing to pay for those goods and services at different quantities. So demand has to do with the desire to buy something and the ability to pay for it. Both must be present. Remember, we all want a lot, but we can't have it all. The law of demand states that when stuff is cheaper, consumers will buy more of it. When stuff is more expensive, consumers will buy less of it. In other words, the price of a good or service combined with your ability to pay for it will determine your decision as a consumer whether or not to buy. For example, would you buy a slice of pizza if it was $2? Most of us would answer yes. What if that same slice of pizza was $4? Fewer of us would, perhaps just those who really love pizza. Now, what if that slice of pizza was $20? Very few of us would. Perhaps we would buy it only if we were starving and knew that there would be no other opportunity to buy food for a long time. Now, there are many variables which can influence demand. One such variable is known as the substitution effect, which takes place when a consumer reacts to a rise in the price of something by consuming less of that thing and more of a similar alternative, which we can refer to as a substitute. For example, when the price of pizza becomes more expensive compared with other foods, consumers become more likely to buy a substitute food item, like tacos or hamburgers. Another such variable is the income effect. Rising prices make us all feel more poor. When prices rise, we cut back on what we buy if our income does not go up. When you buy less of something without increasing your purchase of other things, that is the income effect. So if the price of a slice of pizza goes from $2 to $3, you might buy only 3 slices instead of 4. We can illustrate this in a demand schedule, which is a table that lists the quantity of something that a person will buy at various prices in a market. Sticking with the pizza example, in the first column, we have the price of a slice of pizza, from $1 all the way to $6. And in the second column, we have the quantity demanded, which might be 5 slices when they are only a buck, and decreasing by 1 for every dollar increase in slices, in the limit of $6 per slice, where it is deemed by the consumer to be too expensive to purchase. Now, what if we plotted these numbers on a graph? The result would be a downward sloping demand graph, also commonly called a demand curve. This is just a graphical representation of a demand schedule and can be a more useful way of visualizing this data. Okay, with demand covered, now let's look at supply. Supply is the amount of a good or service that is available. So how do producers know how much to supply? Well, according to the law of supply, producers offer more of a good or service as its price increases, and less as its price falls. Economists use the term quantity supplied to illustrate how much of a good or service a producer is willing and able to sell at a specific price. Let's stick with pizza for our example. If the pizza shop is already making money selling lots of slices of pizza all day, the promise of higher revenues generated by each sale motivates the pizza shop to make more pizza. Assuming that the price of pizza were to be set by some outside figure, if the price of pizza rises, but the pizza shop's cost of making pizza stays the same, the pizza shop will earn a higher profit on each slice. the owner of the pizza shop understands that making more pizza makes sense in order to take advantage of the higher prices. Now, perhaps the demand is so high that the pizza shop can't even keep up with the necessary supply. Customers show up, and by noon, there is no more pizza. This may lead to a change in either the price or the supply. Similar to a demand schedule, a supply schedule shows the relationship between price and quantity supplied for a specific good or service, or how much of a good or service a supplier will offer at various prices. Like a demand schedule, a supply schedule lists supply for a very specific set of conditions. For example, let's list the price of the pizza in the first column, again from $1 to $6. Then, in the second column, let's list the slices that will be supplied per day, starting with 100 and going up by 50 for each dollar increase in price. Again, we could plot these numbers on a graph, and the result would be an upward-sloping supply graph, commonly called a supply curve. This is a graphical representation of a supply schedule. When buyers and sellers come together in a market, supply and demand have a close relationship. Supply and demand create an equilibrium in the market, which is the point of balance at which the quantity demanded equals the quantity supplied. If we draw the demand and supply curves on the same plot, we can identify the point where the two intersect. This is known as the equilibrium price. At equilibrium, the market is stable because all of the goods and services are consumed. However, supply and demand constantly shift, causing prices to change. Usually, over time, supply and demand will move to new equilibrium levels, which is why we tend to know the price of something when we are shopping. So let's move forward and look more closely at how both supply and demand can change. Thanks for watching. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.